Hello drivers, today we are going to talk about a topic that is buzzing on social media, NFTs. There is indeed a lot to say about non-fungible tokens as they aim to give uniqueness to digital assets in the virtual world, leading to the reminiscence and exacerbation of old and new legal problems in many fields of law. Intellectual property, personal data protection, finance regulation, normativity of the rules, and so on. For the sake of concision, we will focus on the legal and technical implications of this tool in the field of video games. We will start with a brief explanation of the technical side of NFTs, then move to practical examples and legal issues related. This will allow us to talk about Ubisoft's vision and plans to implement NFTs in their video games, supporting an analysis with a close reading of the documentation they have released, including marketing statements, but also Ubisoft Quartz terms of use as well as interviews given by some of the experts in blockchain technology. This is going to be a long but exciting video. Let's start our analysis with the NFT description. Enjoy! So, what is an NFT? Non-fungible tokens are a tool consisting of a unit of data whose function is to give uniqueness to a digital asset. This unit of data is composed of a smart contract that contains the code with the information identifying a particular digital asset, thus making it non-fungible. First thing that comes to mind is pictures, as this is how NFTs enter the public sphere, but in fact it can be any digital asset, music, video, collectible, membership access, etc. What's the point, you may ask? The promise of NFTs is to empower consumers by giving them autonomy and control over the digital assets through decentralization. To achieve this, it uses the blockchain technology to ensure the security of the information stored in a smart contract. A smart contract is a self-executing contract where the terms of the agreement between two parties are written into lines of code. Different standards exist on their content. ERC 721 is currently the most used, but smart contracts at least contains the link to the digital asset and the current owner of such link. Once minted, which means writing the smart contract code and putting it on the blockchain, the NFT can be placed in a crypto wallet and be used anywhere a use is intended. On Twitter, for example, you will be rewarded with an hexagonal shape picture profile if you link your crypto wallet that has an NFT image in it. But be aware that the NFT is not the digital asset itself, only a receipt pointing to the asset. This already has legal implications for the supposed ownership you get by acquiring the NFT. Moreover, while NFTs can be considered secure, it is not the case of the metadata representing the digital asset to which the link is pointing as it is located off-chain. Off-chain means that the security provided by the blockchain is non-existent, just like a hyperlink to a deleted page. Even if you can guarantee that the hyperlink will be remembered no matter what, if the content it points to can be changed or deleted, then it is meaningless. This is why any chain of cryptographic links needs a chain of legal links acting as armor to really ensure trust and the security of the information as a whole. We could discuss the technical aspect and what it implies for hours, but let's move on to the video games applications of NFTs. In this area, Ubisoft can be credited with being the first major publisher to test the waters with Ubisoft Quartz, the name of the ecosystem where NFTs are called digits and which are cosmetic items with a twist, resellability. Quartz runs on the Tezos blockchain, not the more common Ethereum, and this choice is motivated by an environmental concern as it uses the proof-of-stake protocol and not proof-of-work, which essentially requires less computing power to complete a transaction on the blockchain. At this stage, they have limited Quartz to just one of their games and not the most famous, Ghost Recon Breakpoint. However, this first trial is intended to be a starting point for NFT implementation and Ubisoft's aim is clearly to extend it to their entire portfolio, which would bring other benefits such as asset interoperability, at least on paper. But back to Breakpoint. If we read the marketing releases, digits will give players more control, but they never give clear examples of what this increased control actually entails. Instead, they directly refocus the goals of digits on other grounds, such as getting an exclusive and limited gaming experience with your name stored and tracked in the digits you have earned or purchased. again, they don't really explain how this will improve your gaming experience over traditional microtransaction. So in the end, the only addition to digits is that you can sell it on a third authorized platform acting as a secondary market. The prices are in cryptocurrencies, in this case XTZ, which is the cryptocurrency of the Tezos blockchain. If we take a look at the homepage of one of these secondary markets, in this case Rarible, we can see that the prices freely set by the users can range from 4 XTZ to 100. Considering that one XTZ is currently worth about $4, the prices are very high. This observation is countered by the way digits are obtained. Play to earn with eligibility criteria such as a specific rank level, specific in-game action such as killing someone at more than 400 meters, or the number of hours played. For example, if you want to drop the helmet for free, you need to have more than 600 hours in the game. On Rarible, the only helmet that is not currently up for auction is being sold for almost 70,000 XTZ. What's interesting is that as blockchain technology is now to do, we have access to the purchase history of the item and we can see that the current owner bought it for only 37 XTZ, which is still about $130 just for cosmetic item. While we are on the listing page of an item, we can also see that at the moment the creator of the item, so Ubisoft, does not get royalties on each item sale, but the secondary market platform does. If we read the terms of Rarible, we learn that the royalties are 5% on each sale, and it does not mean that Ubisoft will never choose to collect royalties. Far from it. It's time to leave the Ubisoft Quartz homepage to start looking at the legal stuff, starting slowly with the FAQ. Speaking of royalties, Ubisoft reserves the right to charge commissions in the future. We can assume that it is a safe choice on Ubisoft's part to launch Quartz without charging commissions, as NFTs already have a pretty bad reputation. But it could also be motivated by another reason: financial regulations. Indeed, if NFTs were considered as securities, strong obligations would have to be respected by the entities, and Ubisoft would be considered as a broker and could face very high penalties if it does not comply with all the regulations. At present, no financial regulator has made a statement on this issue, but the involvement of the commissions could be a consideration in favor of securities. Better safe than sorry, and further statements from Ubisoft may confirm this expression. Now it's time to go deeper in the legal reading with the text that nobody reads, the terms of use. Looking at point 7.5, Ubisoft's intentions are clearer than ever, using capital letters for good measure. The digit is intended for consumer enjoyment, use and consumption only. It is not a security. Two remarks. It is not Ubisoft to say what it is and what is not a security. This will depend on a use case and analysis from a financial regulator. Secondly, the first part of the point says that it is only for consumer enjoyment, which kinda contradicts Ubisoft's public description of the digits and the enlarged control they offer to the gamers. Note that this statement is made in the disclaimers section of the terms of use, and the other points are equally interesting. Point 7.2 reminds us of regulatory evolutions just like we did, while point 7.3 basically tells us that Ubisoft has no control over the use of the blockchain. This shows another contradiction with Ubisoft declarations, in this case Ubisoft's vision for blockchain by Nicolas Pouard, vice president of Strategic Innovation Lab at Ubisoft, who said established industry actors need to act as gatekeepers and create the conditions for trust by implementing this technology in safe, familiar environments and in ways that make sense both for the medium and ultimately for the players. This will be key to helping players grasp the benefits of this new model that lets them create value in digital worlds. He even appropriates the term gatekeepers, but as it was the case for securities, the conditions and criteria to fulfill are not under Ubisoft's appreciation, but rather the regulator as it relates to the normativity of law. It constitutes an important knowledge delegation that is not easily given. Anyway, it will be complicated to consider Ubisoft as a gatekeeper if they also declare in the terms of use that they don't have any control on the blockchain, including the digits transaction performed in it, or even underlying security weaknesses. The discrepancy between what the blockchain specialist and the legal team are saying is indicative of the vagueness in which Ubisoft are moving with NFTs. But to be fair, this issue is not limited to Ubisoft, as the blockchain technology still has unanswered questions when it comes to legal compliance. One of these issues revolves around the protection of personal data. Point 8 of the terms of use states that some of your personal information, including your Ubisoft username and your crypto wallet public address, will be embedded into the digits and will be stored for as long as the underlying blockchain technology operates. That is indeed how blockchains works, but also a big problem for the exercise of data subjects' rights, such as the right of rectification or the right to be forgotten. Because when you have sold an item, the transaction history will still show your username even if the item is sold 4 times after you. That is because the blockchain is supposed to provide security of information, not protection of personal data. That said, the problem is less in the case of Ubisoft Quartz, as the information is not as sensitive as it might be in other cases, but that doesn't mean it is compliant. Our last but not least stop for today's video will be intellectual property, a topic we already touched on briefly in the technical explanation. We can now use Ubisoft's terms of use to confirm that NFTs do not give ownership of the digital asset to which they are linked. Indeed, Section 5 is devoted to this relationship between the NFT and the digital asset, in this case the cosmetic object, and the subheadings leave no room for doubt. The player owns the NFT, Ubisoft owns the visual representation for which Ubisoft grants a limited license for the purposes of the game experience and market transfers only. Furthermore, the ownership of the NFT itself is not under Ubisoft's control, as the smart contract is stored on the blockchain, making it fragile if Tezos decides to make changes. But NFTs also have an uncertain future due to Ubisoft's own decisions about the state of the game they are linked to. As the closure of Hyperscape showed, online-only games now have an expiration date. What happens when Ghost Recon Breakpoint's servers shut down? That is indeed one of the questions in the FAQ, but the answer is misleading. Since NFTs are not the cosmetic item itself, Ubisoft considers that digits do not end with the game, as it is still possible to transfer digits to the blockchain, if it still exists, and access the metadata that acts as a certificate of ownership. But let's be honest, what purpose and value will remain if the digital asset to which the NFT is linked no longer exists or can no longer be used? One solution will be NFT interoperability. This means that the NFT stays in the crypto wallet, and instead of using it in Ghost Recon Breakpoint, you use it in another Ubisoft game. But it is very hypothetical and linked to the technical feasibility of such digital assets transfers, which are far from easy. Even if it were possible, the art direction of the Ubisoft games is too different for this interoperability to be viable, in my opinion. Something from one of Ubisoft's realistic rules will not fit in Rayman and vice versa. It is certainly something Ubisoft are thinking about, as NFTs could be the next business model for their games, especially Assassin's Creed Infinity, which is planned to be a platform for Assassin's Creed content. This direction is supported by the latest interviews regarding future plans for NFTs for Ubisoft. The famous players didn't get NFTs, but the interview says more than that. It's still Nicolas Pouard, so not a legal expert, and even though he said that NFTs is beneficial for gamers, I still don't see any example to back up these statements. Anyway, the state of NFTs is also important for us, the driver fans, if Ubisoft decide to release a new game. But even without this, there is also the Binge platform where the official live action adaptation will be aired on, which has a business model that is relying on NFTs and watch to earn rewards, very close to the play to earn model of Ubisoft Quartz. The gamers' reception and legal evolutions surrounding NFTs is therefore important to follow, and I might do further videos on the subject, especially if you like this first introduction to a more legal side of the matter. Please tell me in the description, no, please tell me in the comment what you think of the video. Hopefully you stay till the end. Indeed, I realized that it has a duration of 15 minutes and it took me the whole day to edit, but it was also a nice way for me to research the subject of NFTs. I guess the next step for cryptocurrencies and NFTs will be made through a collaboration between the law and IT field to develop the technology in a direction that benefits society. And it's easier said than done, trust me. Thanks to driverdimension.com, French Contact, NeoWatsins, Tenkon on YouTube, Paul Lanois, Emmett McLaughlin, CarGuy50, Donny Frontier, and Mute for being members of the channel. You can also join the ReDriver Club and enjoy many rewards by clicking on the blue join button below the video. And in any case, see you soon, drivers.